a special day.
Yeah, it's good to be here.
Yes,
Sister Mary and Brother Fred, I'm sure Kevin and Kim will be coming into that picture there in a minute too, right? Okay, Kim, we got the camera going for you, so.
Can you get it with the glare of the window here?
Can I get it what?
Are you getting us?
Yeah, it's supposed to be a taken.
It's nice to have Kevin and Kim.
Yeah, it's good to have Kevin and Kim here with us.
Okay. That'll be fine. Go ahead and tell them like you told them a while ago, Brother Fred.
Glad you're here for our special day.
Yeah, I'm glad to be here, and I love you all.
Glad to have Kim and Kevin here, too.
And we're glad to all have you be here, too.
We appreciate you, Brother Baker.
Yes, we sure do.
Yeah. Well, I thought I had it in my fade, but I guess I didn't.
Come to be with us. This is
Pastor's Appreciation Day was set aside, and we found out that there's other Pastor Appreciation Days going on close in this district. Brother Carl Pruitt, Brother Roger Lance. We're going to have Brother Cornelius and Sister Cornelius come now. We want them to sit right up here, and Sister Paula and her helper come, and we're going to pin a corsage on them. We've got a little program planned this morning. We're glad for Mr. Daryl Bennett. He come by, cleaned his white limousine up, and went by and surprised the pastor and his wife. And we certainly want to thank him for his services. And he's staying for the service, and we've made dinner arrangements. Yeah, special friend of the pastor, and he wanted to ask him, well, can you do it? Well, sure, I'll do it for Freddie. So we're glad to have him. We're certainly glad to have Sister Cornelius, the pastor's mother, with us. This is our pastor's starting his 33rd year of ministry here with this church. Okay. Sister Mamma Cornelius, they've got a corsage I'd like to put on you too. Would you come up here a minute? Now, she's a faithful member, attends the Goshen Church of God, and fills the pew there. Yes. Right. The pastor's father used to pastor this church. Move right along here with our birthdays or anniversaries and things like that, to get that out of the way before we get started with the program. So who has a birthday? Anybody with a birthday? No birthdays? What about anniversaries? Are there any anniversaries this morning? None of those. Okay. Well, we've got $3 to give away to some lucky boys or girls. I'm certainly glad to have some of my family here this morning. That's TC and Mary. They've relocated down around La Follette. And TC act like it's almost heaven down there. Ain't that something? It's a beautiful place he's got down there, and good neighbors. Yes, Earl Pierce has come in. Another special friend of the pastor and his wife. We're glad to have Earl with us. He's come just to be helping us celebrate with our pastor this morning. What about Adam? No, what about Adam's brother? Hey, back in Garland, come up here, Garland. I'm going to let him help me pull some winners out of here. Is Mark Skeens. The second winner is Jay Philbeck. And the third winner is Andrea Jones. Come on up, winners. Okay. a messenger announcement that was just handed to me. On October the 24th and 25th, we will be taking family photos. This will include our church directory. So if you have any questions about that, see Dana, and she would like for you to help sell coupons for these photographs. That's on the 24th and 25th. Dana, where are you? Stand up, Dana. This is Dana. This is the coupon lady. Okay. I've got something that I'd like to read. It was read sometime a few years back on a Pastor's Appreciation Day, but I kind of like to read it just before Brother Baker comes. And it says, many can speak and teach and reach out in faith to others. God bless them, everyone. Beyond that, there are those who have an intangible quality which comes from the heart of God, which calls them to the role of pastor. The voice you use tells of the grace of the loving and living God. Your gentle hand leads us in the ways of His righteousness. The deep sense of care you show as you listen and counsel reminds us of the tenderness of our compassionate Lord Jesus Christ. You reach beyond yourself, drawing from the wellsprings of living water. Thank you, Pastor, for all you are. May you continue to have the strength to endure, to love, to mend broken hearts and lives, and the true wisdom and true wisdom only Son, only God can give. We praise God for His wonderful gift to us. God bless you, Pastor. This morning, when we speak of the pastor, we're speaking of Sister Mary as well as a team. So we're going to have, right now, we're going to have Brother Merle Baker come and say what's in his heart. He's going to do something very important.
Thank you, Brother Louis. Last year, when we had Pastor's Appreciation Day, I approached Brother Louis and told him that I would like an opportunity to express my feelings to my family. I came to the Monroe Church just about 4 years ago now. At the invitation of Brother and Sister Johnson, and I want to thank them publicly for helping me and strengthening me all the years that they've been my friends and so forth. I have an opportunity, as well as many of you, I can choose my friends, where I want to go, and so forth, on my own time. I do have an obligation to make a living. I have to go in areas and places where I don't like to go, and it hurts me a lot of times. But I know I can feel comfortable associating with any of my brothers and sisters in church, and it makes me feel so great to know that I look forward to each Sunday morning and Sunday night and Wednesday night to be able to be here. I love my pastor and his wife and family. I know I can feel free at any time that I wish to call them at night or day. I would not take advantage of this and abuse it, but I know that I would feel welcome to make the call at any time I would wish. I love Brother and Sister Murray with all of my heart, as well as all of my brothers and sisters here. And I look around and I see the young people. Last Sunday night, we had heaven to come down in church here. We have one of the best services that we've had since we've been coming to church, I feel. And I heard Brother Robin, 32-year-old, makes the statement that he didn't remember when it was anything but Brother Fred and Sister Mary being here. We work in jobs where we have an opportunity to look forward to retirement. And at the retirement, they give us a watch, for a small gift or something other. But Brother and Sister Murray has an opportunity to look around and see the children and the different ones that they've helped to come to God and know that they've got something forward to look forward to that's going to be beyond any little watch or anything like that. Brother and Sister Murray, I love both of you, and I hope to have many, many years here with you, but we're also looking forward to spending eternity in heaven with you. God bless both of you on that part. I'd like to take an opportunity also to invite each and every one to participate in the love offering that we are giving today. I'd like the ushers to bring the other praise at this time if they would. We'll have an offering march and come around the front and get your gratitude and love to come up here.
we could all just merge and turn around for the rest of it.
Service this morning. We want to give honor to our pastor and his wife for the, and we're thankful for the Lord that he's kind of put us together this morning. Mr. Darrell Bennett, like to say something this morning. He had something between him and the, come on, Darrell. He had something between him and the pastor come about, and he'd like to share that with the congregation.
Thank you very much. Appreciate it.
It's really nice to be here this morning when the pastor's son-in-law called and said that he'd like to pick him up, and when I come and do that, I said, I'd be more than delighted. But I've known Fred Cornelius now for about 20-some-odd years. We've been on lots of funerals together. I've called him a lot of times and asked him different things. You know, he's never refused yet, so it just keeps getting better all the time. But anyway, we were on a funeral not long ago, me and another pastor, and we were talking about we should be able to do something for the people that was in this horrible disaster that we had in Florida. Speaking of, of course, the hurricane. So, within a matter of an hour, we only had like 15 minutes till deadline to the paper. We called them. They put this on the front page. Then, in turn, I called the different pastors in this community that I knew. One of them, of course, being Reverend Cornelius. When I called him, he was more than gracious to help. He even made a promise at that time. Well, I want to tell you something. He didn't just fulfill that promise. He did it threefold. We sent 12,500 pounds of canned goods to Florida within 36 hours. After that, we sent another 40-some thousand pounds. It went straight into Homestead and was unloaded right by the people. So I thought that was really great. But I just want to thank this church and what they did. I think that you'll be more than blessed for it. Thank you so much. Amen. Thank you.
Thank you, Mr. Bennett, for sharing that with us. This morning, we have a lot of the classes. They have special gifts for the pastor and his wife. And we want to get right along with that because I can see they can hardly wait to share these things with their pastor. Is that right, Nathan? Is that right? Nathan's really excited up here on the front row, I can tell. If I could use for a thought or a theme this morning, I would call it double honor for our pastor. And I know that's biblical, and I know it's scripture. It's taken from 1 Timothy 5:17. It says, let the elders that rule well be counted worthy of double honor, especially they who labor in the word and doctrine. And I think we have a pastor like that. And I want to share some of the reasons why I think that this morning. And but first, we're going to have each class go ahead and present your gifts to the pastor. So we'll start right with the preschool class, and that's Sister Shirlene and Sister Donna. Where's that class at? Okay. They're real close. Yeah. Oh, they want you to step down here. If you want to take some pictures, you're more than welcome to do that. Kindergarten class, Sister Newton's class. Come on up with Sister Newton, and Jeanette is her helper. All the kindergartners in Sister Newton's class, come up with her.
George.
please accept the flowers with love and appreciation. Plant them and nurture them and love them, and they will grow and blossom, just as we have grown and blossomed, and under your ministry and your love and your guidance that you have shown us through the years. We love you and we thank you. The beginner's class.
Okay. 2, determination. 3, the anointing of the Holy Ghost. 4, hunger for souls. 5, realize you're in a battle. 6, setting your affections on things above. 7, be fervent in prayer. And 8, working together. And the children's church has a song that they want to sing for the pastor and choir this morning. I'd like them to come and start getting ready to sing that song. It's a precious song. And then last Sunday, he preached about the importance of prayer. The conditions of a successful prayer and the hindrance to prayer. Some of the hindrances to prayer he mentioned was disobedience, secret sin, stubbornness, indifference, neglect of mercy, self-indulgence, and then he didn't leave us there. He took us to the attitude of success in prayer when having the proper attitude. And he quoted the scriptures from the scripture from 2 Chronicles 7:14. And my people, which are called by my name, shall humble themselves and pray, and seek my face, and turn from their wicked ways. Then will I hear from heaven, will forgive their sin, and will heal their land. I think what we've heard from the beginning of 92 up until last Sunday has been the pastor speaking from his heart. I believe it's connected to the real life. And I know you're thankful, just as I'm thankful, that we have a pastor that has a pure heart, a loving heart, and cares for our souls. And right now we're going to Sister Dana and her children sing a special song in honor of Pastor Dana.
First we'll read this part. It says, Brother Francis, Sister Mary, there's a word for people like you. Terrific. Thanks. We love you both. And this is from the Children's Church. And we have a precious moment. And the name of this God bless our home. And I'll tell you, I want to thank the Lord while I'm here for coming.
gift that we had a meeting last Sunday night, and this is what we decided to do. And we're going to do this different next year. We're going to do it more organized and better.
We want to apologize to the pastor and his wife for not doing as well as we should have this year, but we want them to know that we decided that we want them to have from the church a gift of clothes. Now we want the pastor to go to make an appointment. In fact, one of the brothers in the meeting said he would take the pastor to make sure that
he went to the right store. He wouldn't talk about Kmart or Myers, but take him to the clothing store to let him buy a complete set of clothes. That meant sport coat, dress slacks, or suit, shirt, tie, socks, shoes, cologne, whatever, okay? And then we want Sister Mary to do the same. And if some of you, you won't hardly need to cry her out to the shopping store. In fact, let me tell you something. I've been in the family now 19 years or so, don't live it longer than that. And I run around with them a little bit, and we went to some places, and Sister Mary gets so excited about getting there, the door will come open before Brother Cornelius can stop the car. She hits the ground running. So we'd like for her to go and get that dress, the shoes, the pocketbook, the perfume, the nylon, whatever, as a gift from the church, from you this morning. And I have a gift from the Sunday school for $200 we wanted to give to the pastor for some gasoline expense. And then he may want to try to trade Mr. Bennett out of that limousine today. So that could be a down payment for that. We're going to give you a chance to do that. A little bit. Another thing that I thought of, one of the greatest compliments you can pay somebody is when you emulate them. Or sometimes you're not making fun of them, but you try to be like them. That is one of the greatest compliments you can pay a person. And now I believe we have a young man that's been evangelizing. And I believe wherever he goes, I've not heard him out and about, but wherever he goes, I can't help but think that everywhere he goes, they hear a little bit of Reverend Cornelius. And Brother Al has been raised in the church, has fine Christian parents, and the Lord has called him into the ministry. And I believe he's doing a little immolating, or I think he wants to reflect Brother Cornelius as he reflects Christ the Father. And I'm going to let him come and say what's under his heart. And read a poem for us, of course, this morning.
Pastor Fred, Sister Mary. Luke said it already, but the Bible talks about having mentors. I want you to know, Brother Fred, you're my spiritual mentor. I have a great father. But Brother Fred has been more than just a pastor to me. He has been someone that I've come and talked to when I didn't have direction. He was someone who loved me in spite of what I was before I was a Christian. He's been one to give me advice, counsel me. When I first announced my call to the ministry, I went to Brother Fred and he said, "One advice I give you," he says, "study the word." Brother Louis said that he is an elder who deserves double honor. He's a man of the word. I've sat in his office on days and come out here to talk with him. I sat at his home and spoke with him. I called him on the phone. And he's more than a pastor. You're a father, Brother Fred. Sister Mary, you're a mother. I don't know about you, but when Sister Mary's not here, folks, I miss her. I feel as though the family has lost a vacancy. We miss her as well as the pastor. You see, because I don't separate the two. I Consider a marriage. Jesus said that when the two hearts come together, he makes them one flesh. And we were honored and graced with a pastor such as Brother Fred. He also gave us Sister Mary. I've only known you as a pastor for 24 years. You're the only pastor. I've evangelized and I've met many pastors and their wives, and I call them pastor. But I call Brother Fred more than just a pastor. He's my pastor. He's your pastor. He loves us, and I love him. Now, one thing about Sister Mary is that she loves to shop. I also know she's very fond of pictures. I was over at her house knee-deep in mud. What does Sister Mary do besides offer that great glass of holy water Pepsi? She goes, let me take a picture. Well, I want you to know, Sister Mary and Brother Fred, I've got a picture of you. It's not a Polaroid. It's not a Kodak moment. But it's in my heart. We don't have a gold watch to give you after 33 years of service, but God will give you a golden crown. And I believe there will be something special in heaven, because you're special to me, more than you'll know. And if I can't emulate you, I can do anything I can. If someone can refer to me and say, I see something of Brother Fred in you, I'll take that as a compliment, Brother Fred. And I appreciate that. Have a poem we'd like to read this morning. It says that someone like you makes the heart seem light. Someone like you makes the day's work worthwhile. Someone like you makes the sunshine brighter. Someone like you makes a sigh half a smile. Life's an odd pattern of briars and roses. Clouds sometimes darken with sunshine through. But then the cloud lifts and the sun shines through and discloses you, which is near to me, dear to me, someone like you. I love you more than I can ever express. All I ever wanted to be able to do is call you.
Spoiler.
she would do him good and not evil all the days of her life. For her husband is known in the gates when he sitteth among the elders of the land. He maketh fine linen and sell it, and delivereth girdles unto the merchant. Strength and honor are her clothing, she shall rejoice in time to come. She opened her mouth with wisdom, and her tongue is the law of kindness. She looketh well in the way of her household, and eateth not the bread of idols. Her children arise up and call her blessed. Her husband also, he praises her. Give her of the fruit of her hands, and let her own works praise her in the gates. I think the pastor has a wife like that, and I know that he appreciates her in a special way. And we love and appreciate this team. We're going to ask you to prepare, and some of the ones, the ensemble, we're going to help her prepare that song and sing that. And it's entitled, Thank You.
Change. multitude started toward you and said, "We are all your sheep. You were our shepherd. For 33 years you did keep. You loved and cared for us. Your life, your own life you denied. Many trials you've seen us through, and with us you have cried. One by one they came, as far as the eye could see. Each life somehow touched by your generosity. Little things that you have done and sacrifices made. Unnoticed on the earth, in heaven now proclaimed. And I know up in heaven you're not supposed to cry. But I am almost sure there were tears in your eyes as Jesus took your hand and you stood before the Lord. He said, "My child, look around you, for great is your reward. Thank you for giving to the Lord. I am a life that was changed. Thank you for giving to the Lord. I am so glad you gave. Thank you for giving to the Lord. Was changed. somehow touched by your generosity. Little things that you had done, sacrifices made, unnoticed on the earth, in heaven now proclaim. And I know up in heaven you're not supposed to cry, but I am almost sure there were tears in your eyes as Jesus took your hand and stood before the Lord. He said, my child, look around you, for great is your reward. Thank you for giving to the Lord. I am a life that was changed. Thank you for giving to the Lord. I am so glad you gave. Thank you for giving to the Lord. I am a life that was changed. Thank you for giving to the Lord. I am so glad you gave. In heaven, you're not supposed to cry, but I am almost sure there were tears in your eyes as Jesus took your hand and you stood before the Lord. He said, my child, look around you, for great is your reward. To the Lord.
wonderful, wonderful spirit. We thank God for you. We're going to give the pastor in just a moment a chance to say thanks. But we want to honor his mother here. And we pinned a little corsage on her this morning. But we love her. Kevin, bring her up here. And Brother Al, we thank God for a mother and a grandmother like this. A former pastor's wife. Here at this church, Reverend Roy Cornelius pastored this church back in the 40s. We want to present this pot of flowers. And we'd like for you to say something.
That is really sweet of you. And I thank you for it. And it, like Louis said, it's been such a great, wonderful spirit here this morning that it just makes you want to rejoice and makes you want to cry. And I love the Lord this morning, and I appreciate Fred and Mary and their family, and I appreciate all the church here. If he didn't have this church, what would you do? What would you do without the people? And he's got a wonderful family, and I'm not prejudiced, I don't believe, because just looking around this morning and seeing everyone with that good, sweet spirit, but part of me is not here this morning. He's in heaven, and I'm going to meet him someday. And I'm so proud of my children, them that serve in the Lord. I've got two wonderful. I tell Brother McKinney that he is precious. He's one of my special, but I've got two more that's special, more special. But I love the Lord, and I appreciate everyone, and I've got a wonderful family. Some of them's not saved, but I'm trusting God, and I know Roy's prayers and my prayers that someday that they'll be saved. I'm believing that. Hallelujah. You know, we've got to believe that. Praise God. And I'm believing that this morning. I thank you, Louie. Thank you for all the family.
Dessert to bring tonight. We'll be serving right after the evening service. Brother Paul Wigan is going to be preaching. Bring back the same spirit with you. We're going to give the pastor just a moment to say something, but he has dinner arrangements at 1 o'clock and up the road. He doesn't know about Brother Mr. Darrell Bennett's got to get him there by 1 o'clock.
I didn't know that. Of course, I always like dinner arrangements. I thank you so much for this special day. So good to have my mother here this morning. Dad pastored this church 40 years ago. Three years ago yesterday was Dad's funeral. And it's been kind of a sad week us thinking of Dad gone, but he's gone where we're wanting to go. I thank God for every one of you. I always feel at ill at ease in this type of service. I thank everybody, and I hope everybody knows that I appreciate everything that you've done today and everything that you do all the time during the year. But I do feel ill at ease. I'd rather be sitting on the front seat there and letting somebody else be up here. But we do appreciate your expression of appreciation. One thing I felt like just ending this service with a song that we a lot of times we counted as our theme song, because there's only one reason that we're here, all of us, and I think that's to give glory and honor to God. It's good to see Darrell here today, Darrell Bennett. I thought I was going to be late for Sunday school. And I didn't even dream of a limousine coming. That's the first time I ever rode in one. Yeah. And probably the next time, I take that back. I have rode in the front seat of some of them going out to the cemetery, maybe. But next time might be going to the cemetery. We don't know. Darrell, if you do, drive slow with me, buddy. Okay.
Good to see Brother Earl Pierce and everyone. We thank God for you. And I thank Paul Wigginton to be preaching tonight in the service. Is that right? Let's just sing this with me, would you? Will he meeting, and Brother Jerry Wilson, pastor of Piqua, Ohio Church, will be preaching in that service. So we want you to remember that. We thank God for you this morning, and should we just go ahead and close?
Yeah. Maybe grab Sister Mary by the hand and head for the door. Okay. Okay. All right. But the pastor would like to have special prayer for Jenny's request. So let's pray however we feel this evening. Father God, we know that you're more than able to meet this need. We pray, God, that you touch this young man with his back. Lord, we know that you're God.
Whoops. I'm getting up in front of you.
No, I'd rather you didn't.
Okay.
Thank you. you.
Encourage.
angels bow before him. Heaven and earth adore him. Angels bow before him. Heaven and earth adore him. Angels bow before him. Heaven and earth adore him. What a mighty God we serve.
Hallelujah. Can you get the Lord a big praise? Hallelujah. Hallelujah.
Amen. Amen. The Lord, what a mighty God we serve. Amen.
Amen.
We could be in another country right now, and we could probably have a lot of famine, a lot of big-time pestilences, and we could be in despair, but we're in America, and Americans believe in a living God. Amen. If nobody else does, we do in this church house. Amen.
Amen.
Amen. I mean, we could worship some stone idol or some cow or some person or some name, but we worship the name above all other names. Amen. By that name only can someone be saved, amen, and receive eternal life. Hallelujah. I feel good tonight. We thank the Lord for all of you being here, and we just want you to just make yourself at home and feel at home and worship with us. For any visitors that are here, we're glad you're here, and we're just going to have a good time in the Lord tonight. Amen. Right now, I think it'd be good as if we come before and receive your prayer requests. And how many believes the Lord can answer prayer? Amen? I honestly believe with all my heart, because it's happened too many times to me for me not to believe. And it's happened too many times to you for you not to believe that the Lord cannot answer prayer. He can answer prayer.
Amen.
And he will, and he's able, and he wants to. You know, the only stipulation in all that is if we just believe. Amen. Such a simple little thing is just believe. And I heard a little illustration today, and I'll share that with you. And as if you didn't know me, it's hard for somebody to believe in the Lord if they never heard of the Lord. And how can they hear about the Lord unless they have a preacher to tell them? Amen. I heard that today, and that stuck with me. And I'm glad we have a minister and a pastor today that preaches the Lord, amen? So you come into this building, you can't go out saying you never heard of him and you don't know him, but you can come today and tonight and you can receive him and know that we can believe, amen? We can believe on the Lord. We're going to go before the Lord in prayer, take our prayer requests, and right now if anybody on this side has got a prayer request, you can make that known at this time. Anybody on this side?
Years now.
first move we have to make. Realization of where we're at. Amen. Peter realized that when he was in the water. The minute we take our eyes off the Lord, we start seeking His circumstances and the troubles and waves around us. And that can happen to any of us. Amen. The minute we take our eyes off the Lord. But I'm glad that all we have to do is, Lord, save me. Amen. And He's not there just to say, no, I have taught you to make me cry out. Amen. Amen. As long as we realize we need the Lord. Amen. Anybody else?
Thank you.
if you have a teen, if you're a teenager, if you're not a teen, see me. that's a little underhanded there. But we like for you to be here and put you on the team. We're having a good time out there. We like for the adults to come out. We've been having a wonderful Bible study. Having a good time out here. Having a good crowd. And so if you haven't been here, you've been missing things. Tuesday night's prayer meeting. 6:30. And Saturday night in Belleville. Is that right? Belleville, we'll be having a fellowship meeting. Starts at 7 o'clock. Jerry Wilson. Well, Jerry Wilson will be speaking, so we want you all to remember that. Make arrangements to be out there. And then we're back here Sunday again. Boy, how time flies when you're having fun. You know, you sit back at Pastor Appreciation Day. Here we are the next Sunday again. Amen. All right. Any other announcements you need to make? All right. Ladies' Day, October the 3rd. For all you ladies. Oh, and another thing. I've seen Sister Paulette, and she asked me, they are in need of gentlemen. I'm not using that term loosely, but we need young and older gentlemen to help. This goes against all teachings I believe in, but to serve the women. And I tell you, I'm just teasing. But she asked if there was any men, since Ladies' Day is going to be here, all men and young men that would like to help, they would like to have them to serve the women. So the rest of the women that's planning to serve can, you know, sit in on the meeting and enjoy this. And I believe it's going to start about 9:30. So if you want you to make plans for that. All right. Is everybody happy this tonight? I almost said this morning I just woke up. No, I haven't missed it. How many's not happy? Well, I only see 5 hands that said they were happy, so I figured the rest of you are pretty sad off. So how many's happy tonight in the Lord? Amen? Good time to see an offering. Let's all stand, if you would. The ushers made their way on up here. Now, if you raise that hand, I'll go right back down into the pocket. And we pull it out. don't know nobody like that, do we? Amen. And they had a couple of other sisters. I'm trying to make it real dignified. It says, we don't want you shouting like that in our church. And they told the pastor, they said, we better go over and talk to her about it. You know, we don't want to just talk behind her back. We want to go and talk to her about it. So they went over to our house and they got a little closer and heard some noise rapping in there. And said, we, something's going on in there. What is that? So they knocked on the door and here she comes out. She's wiping tears from her eyes, got her apron on, and she's got a mop in her hand. She says, well, hello, sisters and pastor. Come on in. You kind of caught me at a bad time. And I said, I was mopping the floor, but I got to thinking of all of the good things that the Lord has done for me. And I just couldn't help myself. Started shouting right here in the house, you know. And she said, and one of the ladies said, that's what we come here for, to tell you. We don't want you shouting in our church anymore. You just can't be doing that. And she says, well, let me tell you something. You know, the Lord has blessed me. And she said, I got saved at a young age. My kids are serving the Lord. I married a preacher. And we've been serving the Lord all this time. He's healed in our family. And you don't want me to praise the Lord in your church? And one of the other sisters says, yeah, you don't want us to praise the Lord in your church? Got to change sides. When you start thinking about what the Lord is doing, amen, you just can't help yourself from shouting a little. Amen. Somebody say, praise the Lord, amen. Praise the Lord, amen. If you can't get excited, yeah, if you can't get excited about what the Lord has done,
and if you don't know how to praise the Lord, well, how do I praise like them? Think about what the Lord's done for you, and it'll get you a little excited about that, amen. We're going to have some special singing, and I believe, Brother Kevin, you and Kim's got something. Boy, he's right up there. Come on up, buddy. Where's Kim? She's right behind me. They're going to sing.
I thank the Lord for what he's done for me and for everything he's given me and everything he's done for us and for my new husband. And he's always right up like that, and I'm always just laying around, and just I'm lazy. But I thank the Lord that in this day and age that there's not much hope for anything, but we do have a hope for heaven. And what this song is another time and another place, and we'll see Jesus. So pray for us.
Those of another time.
Spirit's move in my life.
I know it's truly just a taste of His glory in another place.
Through, amen, through this earthly life and looking for heaven, and just to see Jesus' face, amen, is going to be worth it all, amen. Pam, come and give us a song. Amen. Thank the Lord. Don't get quiet on us out there. Somebody say amen.
Amen.
All right, I'll just make sure you're all still awake.
Christ. No, I am not afraid.
withheld mercy for all the love that he's shown all my life. A simple thanks doesn't say how I am feeling. I get tears in my eyes. But as for me, I'm gonna keep on believing that one who has been so faithful to me. I'm not out to please this whole world around me. I've got my mind on eternity. That's why I am not ashamed of the gospel.
Ashamed in the church house, amen?
Oh, yes.
But to go outside because we got people dying, amen, out there that don't know the Lord.
Right.
And we need to be raised up this last day to be firm and grounded in the Lord, in the Word, the good news, amen, of Jesus Christ.
Yes.
Something great. We treat it like a plague. We don't think we want nobody to know about it. Are you a Christian? Yeah, I'm a Christian.
Yeah.
But this is something that is exciting to us, amen? Something that's greater than any possession that I have, anything that I could ever hope for, amen, hallelujah, is the salvation that Jesus Christ has given me, and I don't want to be ashamed of it, amen, hallelujah. Karen, come and give us a song. After this, we'll get ready to turn the service over.
My heart, you
praise your name. Let's all stand if we would. Brother Paul comes. Now tonight we're getting ready to change the order to service, and we're going to have the word brought. Amen. We can feel the Spirit of the Lord move in every song. It can touch hearts, and you might have a need tonight, or that person next to you might have a need. Whether they got a broken heart, financial problem, they might need to be saved.
That's right.
They just might need the Lord. So I don't want no talking.
Amen.
Young people, the one you're standing next to might not make it to heaven, so we don't want to disrupt anything, because they might find the Lord tonight.
That's right. Amen.
And what better day on our pastor's appreciation day, and I know he wouldn't mind one bit, if you come and found the Lord today.
Yes.
And you know, we would just start a big old party in heaven when you come here, because all the angels rejoice, but they wouldn't have nothing over on us.
Amen.
Amen. So I'd like for us, as Brother Paul stand here, let's all just bow our heads. Let's stretch forth a hand up here and ask the Lord just to anoint His Word tonight. Amen. That souls will be touched. Heavenly Father, we thank You, Lord, for this night. We ask for the anointing of the Holy Ghost to be upon Your Word tonight. Upon Your messenger and Your vessel, Brother Paul, God, that You would just be with him and anoint him. God, anoint our ears that would go out, God, that whatever the need may be here tonight, regardless of the situation, that You would just move and that You would just touch, and let the Spirit mold and cultivate in our hearts and our souls. God, that You would save souls, uplift, encourage tonight. Hallelujah. Heal broken homes and hearts and families. Meet financial needs. God, any need that is here tonight, we pray. Hallelujah. We just ask that You move of Your Spirit tonight. Hallelujah. Thank You, Jesus. Praise You.
Amen. Well, I thank the Lord for the sweet spirit that I feel here tonight. Without His Spirit, we can do nothing. For in Him we have, He's our being, He's everything, isn't He? This is Pastor's Appreciation Day, and in 1 Timothy 5 and 17, it says, "Let the elders that rule well be counted worthy of double honor, especially they who labor in the word and doctrine." There's nothing, I don't think, monetary-wise that we could give our pastor that he wouldn't be worthy of. And I thought when I heard and we discussed in the back about getting the limo and picking him up, I thought, you know, it's a good thing. We need to give honor to whom honor is due. And I would like to give honor to my pastor and wife tonight. I thank God for you. And I mean that from the bottom of my heart. I've got the utmost respect for the both of you. And I just thank God and I'm proud to say that you're my pastor. And when I say pastor, I mean that to you too, Mary. And we'll give honor to Brother Fred's mother here tonight too. I tell you what, you've given him a good example. And I know Mary's had one too, and you and your husband, well, let's give them a hand, can we? He's worthy of our honor. But I thought last week when Brother Fred asked me to speak tonight, and it seems funny, but as soon as you asked me that, I come up here and I sit down on the front row and I said, "Well, Lord, what would you have me to speak on?" And this is what He gave me. And Louis turned around and asked me, he said, "Well, what are you preaching on?" I said, "I've already got the thought." He says, "Yeah, but the Lord will change your mind six times over." But the Lord didn't change my mind. And this is the two that the Lord gave me. And if you turn your Bibles over to 1 Corinthians 11 and 1, I'll be reading the first portion of Scripture there. And then I'm going to turn over to 1 Peter 2 and verse 21. It says, "Be ye followers of me, even as I also am of Christ." Now I want you to just picture in your mind Brother Fred reading that tonight, okay? "Be ye followers of me, even as I also am of Christ. And 1 Peter chapter 2 and verse 21 says, "For even unto were ye called, because Christ also suffered for us, leaving us an example that we should follow in his steps." If I use for a thought tonight, it would be to follow the leader. And I thank God that we have a great leader as a pastor in this church. And I think the way he preaches, I think that if we would follow his leading and the unction of the Spirit that the Lord gives him, that he'll lead us right into the promised land, into the heaven. I believe that with all my heart. And I thought of last week as he was preaching, and I just think the Lord's giving you a special anointing, Fred. I don't know if it's because we're in the last days or what, but I think that the Lord is really blessing you and using you to feed the congregation and the sheep here. But the greatest honor that we can give our pastor is to live exactly what he preaches to us. Is that right? He can get up here and we can have the best preacher, we can have the best pastor in the world, but if we don't follow his leading and do what he says, it's done us. We've done ourselves a great injustice, and we're not going to do any good. But I want to put my pastor high up on a pedestal tonight. That's what it's for. But there's one here greater than Fred. There's one here that Fred is following. And he, I felt his presence already here tonight. And I'm here to give him honor, to give honor to whom honor is due. And his name is Jesus. Is that right? He's worthy of all of our praise, the Bible says. The elders are around the throne constantly praising and worship him. And we need to give him honor too. I think sometimes we as a church fail when we hear this singing up here and we hear the great singing that we've heard tonight. When we fail to lift our hand up and say, "I thank you, God, for that promised land that they've sung about. I thank you for that. That another time and another place that you promised me, Lord," and we forget to give him, and we fail to forgive him or give him the honor that's due him. But 1 Peter 2 and 21 there, it says, and using this for a theme, the Bible says, it says there to follow that for Christ also suffered for us, leaving us an example that he should follow in his steps. The first thing that I find out in Jesus' life and step number one is to follow Jesus in his prayer life. Now, Fred preached on that last week, and it just amazed me that when I jotted a couple things down there before service, that when he said that he had something already prepared and the Lord directed him another way, and he went to prayer, and it really touched me. I'll tell you, it's something that maybe we need to hear more of is being prayed up, our prayer life. And the Bible says in Psalms 5 and 3, it says, "My voice shalt thou hear in the morning, O Lord, and in the morning I will direct my prayer unto thee, and I will look up." Psalms 55 and 17 says, "Evening and morning and at noon will I pray and cry aloud, and he shall hear my voice." The Bible says, pray without ceasing. And I'm not going to get into what Fred preached last week, but I just want to touch on it a little bit. Prayer is a vital portion of the Christian's life. Without prayer, you've got no strength. I think I heard him say this, the umbilical cord between us and God. And when we fail to pray, we fail to have a victorious life. When we fail to pray, we fail to commune with God, and we lose out on a lot of things with not praying. It seems like when we get up of a morning and our morning is hurried, and we get up and we think of all the things that we've got to do in a day, and we forget to pray in the morning, and noontime rolls around, and if we forget to pray then, the next thing you know, if you're like me, you're going to work, and you're driving to work, and you think, "Man, I didn't even pray today. What's the matter with me?" And we say a hurried prayer, maybe going to work or something sometimes. You know where I'm coming from? But we find out that when we can get up and we've got heaven on our mind, our day seems to run smooth. It seems like there's not 24 hours in a day, but it just seems like it's spread out. We've got time to do everything when we find the chance to pray. But praying is very, very, very important. I don't think I can stress the importance of prayer. 1 Timothy 2:1-2, it says, "I exhort therefore that first of all supplications, prayer, and intercessions be given of thanks be made for all men, for kings, and for all that are in authority, that we may lead a quiet and peaceable life in all godliness and honesty. I will therefore that all men pray everywhere, lifting up holy hands without wrath and without doubting. We find out here that the Word of God teaches us to pray for our rulers. And I'll tell you something. Last week when Brother Fred was preaching, and it's been a while back that I began beseeching the Lord on a few things, seeking His face, and the Lord laid a few things on my heart. And I tell you, Fred, it really touched me last week when you said, if you've got nothing else to pray for, pray for your pastor. And I'll tell you something, that's one of the things that the Lord laid on my heart to pray for you. You say, is there anything wrong? No, I'm not saying nothing's wrong with Fred. But it just seemed like that when I sought the Lord and it said, pray for your pastor, just lift him up in prayer. And I began to get out on my knees and I began to pray for him. And I said, Lord, I don't know what Fred's experiencing or what he's going through or what the enemy's telling him or anything. But I began to pray and I began to pray and seek the Lord for you. And I thought and I said, Lord, you know, I began to pray. And I said, Lord, help me to bear some of his burdens before I can know it. And it seems like that I've got a burden for you, Fred, not only in that, but when I asked the Lord that, Lord, help me to bear his burden and what he's carrying. Help me to feel some of that load that he's carrying. I'll tell you something, if it's anything, if I'm just carrying a little bit of the load that I've felt the Lord give me, this man's under a terrible load, and we need to pray for our pastor. Is that right? It's commanded that we should do that. But we find out that the Bible says in James 5 and 16, it says, confess your faults one to another and pray one for another that ye may be healed. The effectual fervent prayer of a righteous man availeth much. Now, what are you saying? I'm talking about prayer tonight. I'm saying that we need... Maybe you do it. I don't know. Maybe some don't. But I'm going to tell you, it's the lifeline to God of our prayer. When we get up and we begin to seek the Lord, as it said in Psalms, in the morning I'll direct my prayers unto thee, O Lord. And in the morning I'll look up when we can get on that communion with God and we begin and we start thinking the things and we start praying for our pastor and his wife and we saying, Lord, help Brother Fred. And I'll tell you something. Every Sunday I say, Lord, bless my pastor. Lord, help him through the week to study the fetus. You know what? Wouldn't it be a shame if you come out here on a Sunday and he didn't have nothing to pray, I mean to speak for us? Wouldn't it be a big injustice if you went and you went all week long and you stuck your hand out to your boss and he said, I've got no pay for you today. But it's something, man. That's our bread of life here, what he's preaching to us. And we find out not only for him, but I need to, and I think that we need to get each other and hold them up in prayer. And say, Lord, not only Brother Fred and my pastor, but help out, Lord. And I'll lift Al up, Scott and Robin, and I think that it would be good if we could go through and call each and every one's name out. Back in Lincoln Park when I used to be the superintendent of Sunday school, the Lord impressed me something that what we would do was in each class, the Lord told me to put down each and every name. And as a student would come into class and even the Bible class, it was through the whole church. And I would say, when you come through, you pick a name out. And that's the person that we want you to pray for the whole week. And then when we got that, and everybody had a different name. Maybe somebody didn't get a name, but I'll tell you who the load fell on when enough names wasn't drawn. I said, now teachers, I want you. If there's a lot of names left in here, you pray for them. But don't just take them. Take everybody that's in your class. And you know what? I had a closer walk with the Lord then when I wrote all the names down myself. And each day I would get up and I would call each and every name out. And I would say, Lord, help them through the day. Help them, Lord, encourage them in your word and everything. But when we find out that when we can pray one for another and we can bear one another's burdens, I think when we pray more for each other, we will bear that burden more. Is that right? But we find out there that praying is a battle and it's hard work. How many of us pray all day long? There's a difference between praying in your car. I'm not saying that it ain't good. It's good to pray in your car. there's nothing like the quiet time when we get alone in the closet somewhere or that secret place. Is that right? And it's a different type of prayer then. I'm not saying that the Lord doesn't respect one more than the other, but I think he does honor the one when we get away and we spend that quiet time with him. But we've got, without prayer, we'll never have the victory that we should in Christ. But St. Luke, it tells us in Luke 22, in 39 and 46, what it's talking about. And it's talking about when Jesus went and he went to the Mount of Olives there and he began to talk to his disciples. And it said that he went up, and this is just before Jesus' arrest, before his crucifixion. And it says that when he was at the place, he said unto them, "Pray that ye enter not into temptation." And he was withdrawn from them about a stone's cast and kneeled down and prayed, saying, "Father, if it be thy will, Father, if thou be willing, remove this cup from me. Nevertheless, not my will, but thine be done." And there appeared unto him an angel unto him from heaven strengthening him. And being in agony, he prayed more earnestly. And his sweat, as it was great drops of blood falling down to the ground. And we find out that Jesus, it says that he began to pray more earnestly. And if you ever felt like that, you could pray more earnestly sometimes. You'd be more in agony, and as the Lord lays something on your heart, and you got that burden, and you just start really praying out to the Lord. And sometimes, like Brother Fred said last week, that we can just, sometimes if we don't have to say a word, we can just cry. And if we don't say a word, but it seems like the Lord knows what we're talking about. Is that right? That the Spirit makes intercession for us? But we find out with Jesus praying on the Mount of Olives there and being in agony that he prayed, let's follow the leader in prayer. Is that right? Let's follow Jesus in his prayer life. Let's follow him in prayer. The second thing we want to follow the leader in is follow the leader in obedience. One thing that I can tell you without a shadow of a doubt is Jesus was obedient. He was the most obedient person that I know of. He was obedient in his childhood. He was obedient in his manhood. It even said that he was obedient even to death. Is that right? The Bible even says in Philippians 2 and 8, it says, "Jesus, and being found in the fashion as a man, he humbled himself and became obedient unto death, even the death of the cross." It even says that, "Let this mind be in you, which was in Christ Jesus, but made himself of no reputation, and took upon him the form of a servant, and was made in the likeness of men." Jesus was obedient in all things. I even think it says that when he was hanging on the cross, that the scripture might be fulfilled, he said, "I thirst." That not one jot or one tittle of what he had come to do would not be obediently fulfilled. But he went that way, and he said, "I thirst." And they give him up there that sponge and the vinegar, and they give him that. But Jesus was obedient. We find out that Jesus said in John 4 and 34, Jesus said, "My meat is to do the will of him that sent me and to finish his work." Let's be obedient in the work of the Lord, can we? Let's be obedient in prayer. Let's be obedient in fasting and the things that the Lord wants us to be. Right down to Jesus saying, like I said, down to "I thirst." It amazes me. Right down to the very little thing that the scripture might be fulfilled. He said, "I thirst." You know, if he would have went and just died and didn't say that, the scripture would have been unfulfilled, but he fulfilled it all, didn't he? But we look at, God is looking for obedient children. Is that right? I find out where it talks about the children of Israel, and it says that when Moses come out to him and he read all the commandments of the Lord and everything, and they said all in the congregation, they said, "Everything that the Lord did say, that will we do and be obedient unto it," I think it was. And I think they even had one step further there that went them on a little bit farther than just being obedient. But we find out that they didn't hearken to him. They said it with their mouth, but they wasn't obedient. Let's live the obedient life. Is that right? I think we need to be obedient and come to church. Jesus was at a young age, his father and mother talking there, but we find out that when he gets there and he become a grown man, he went there himself. Is that right? Ain't nobody has to tell you, should call, have to call us up and say it's time to go to church. We should be saying, "I'm ready, let's go, I'm having to wait on you," you know? Let's be obedient there. But even Saul, when he come down, and it said there that, and I want to get this right, it says that when the Lord laid upon Saul's heart, and he told him what to do, go down and utterly destroy all the Amalekites and utterly destroy them, don't bring anything back. And we know the story of how Saul went down with his army. They come down here and they say that they find the king there, Agai. And he gets there and he says that he was a real good person to look upon. And it says that the people saved all the best for the Lord. And they took the choice animals and everything back. And they're coming back and they're thinking, boy, we did the will of the Lord. But we find out the old prophet coming out. And he's saying, Saul, did you utterly do everything that the Lord commanded? Oh, yeah, I've done it all. Everything the Lord commanded, we done. What's this I hear, the bleeding of the sheep? I thought he said, tell you, utterly destroy everything. Don't bring anything back. Oh, but it treat the Lord for us, is what he said. He said, I'll go and treat the Lord for you. And he come back, and so many days I'll come back. He come back, and he says, sorry. I'm talking about obedience, following Christ in obedience. I'm talking in his footsteps. We need to imitate him in his daily life. Help me to get this over, Lord, the way I feel it. As he comes back and he thinks that he's done everything, and that's the way Satan is, if he can just take you just a little bit off and make you think that you've done the right thing, you're all messed up. Is that right? When God says it's a straight and narrow way, folks, and it's right down this way, it don't mean go over this way and go off on the crooked path. It means straight and narrow. But we find out that when he come back and he entreated the Lord for Saul, and I tell you what, Samuel loves Saul. Yeah, I really believe that he loved him. And as he got there, and it says that, and Samuel said, hath the Lord as great delight in burnt offerings and sacrifices as in obeying the voice of the Lord? Behold, to obey is better than sacrifice, and to the hearken than the fat of rams. It says, for rebellion is a sin of witchcraft, and stubbornness is iniquity, and idolatry, because thou hast rejected the word of the Lord. Thou hast rejected, he has also rejected thee from being king. Now I'm going to tell you something. When you reject what the Lord wants you to do, you know what's going to happen? Pretty soon he's going to reject you. Is that right? He might call you to do something, and he might give you a little time to do it, but after a while he's not going to wait out there all day for you and call you. Even the scripture talks about, Jesus said, I think it was, I've called you all day long. Nobody wants to listen. I'm talking about obedience. Can we be more obedient to Christ? I look at my life, and the more that I get into his word, and I find out, it seems like the more rebellious I am. I thank God, help me. I think, Lord, purify me. Help me, Lord. I want to be obedient to you just like Jesus was. I want to be obedient in everything that I do. And we find out also that in obedient and keeping his commandments, and it's not just the Ten Commandments, but as they come and they tempted Jesus and saying, what is the greatest commandment of them all? And he says, on these two hang all the commandments, all everything. He says, thou shalt love the Lord thy God with all thy heart, with all thy soul, with all thy mind. This is the first and great commandment. The second is like unto it, thou shalt love thy neighbor. Thou shalt love thy neighbor as myself. I won't put me in front of them. I won't say it's just me, but I'm going to love them just like I love myself. When I see them in need, I'm not just going to store up my house and say I've got groceries and I don't care if you eat or not. But I think Jesus was obedient. He came and he came to give his life. I think we need to share what we got. Sometimes you know what the Spirit tells us things. I'm going to get into this in a minute, but we're not obedient to it. Sometimes it's just that still, small voice that we need to listen to. But we're too busy and going on with the things and the cares of this world to even listen to what he's got to say to us. But let's follow the leader in obedience, too. Like I say, in coming to church and visiting the sick and paying our tithes and praying and everything, let's be obedient and follow in his steps. Let's follow the leader and also in being led of the Spirit. Now, I find out what the Bible says that when Jesus was baptized and he went straight up out of the water and the Spirit of the Lord descended upon him, in the preceding chapter it says, the very next chapter it says, and the Spirit. You ever read that? It says the Spirit took him or led him into the wilderness to be tempted of the devil. I never thought of that, but as I was studying for this, I thought the Spirit led him. And sometimes we think, why in the world am I going through this and going through that? Sometimes it's because the Spirit is leading you. Maybe we don't see what the Spirit's doing, but he's leading us for a purpose. Is that right? But we find out that when Jesus was led up of the Spirit into the wilderness to be tempted of the devil, it says after he had fasted 40 days and 40 nights, then he came to him. And he attempted him. But in this time that we're living in today, most people are too busy to hear what the Spirit says to them. Amen? We're too busy. We've got everything in the world on our mind except what the Spirit's leading us to do. You know, some of the simplest things for us to do as Christians is to pick up the phone when we have that little tug in our heart, that little thing that speaks to our mind and says, why don't you give such and such a call today? Why don't you just go over and see so-and-so? And all of a sudden you think, and it's, well, I've got this to do, and I've got that to do, and I'll do it tomorrow. Tomorrow's too late. What the person needed when the Spirit was bidden, they needed that today. They needed maybe that just little comfort that's saying, hey, I missed you. You went to church. Are you sick? What's the matter with you? Are we failing to be obedient and doing our job? Jesus wasn't. I would hate to think that if he wasn't obedient in coming and dying for us, where we'd be today. I know where we'd be today, and so do you. But we find out that we need to be obedient. In Galatians 5, let me turn over there, and I'll be closing in just a little bit. Galatians 5:16. It says, this I say then, walk in the Spirit, and ye shall not fulfill the lust of the flesh. For the flesh lusteth against the Spirit, and the Spirit against the flesh, and these are contrary one to another, so that ye cannot do the things that ye would. But if ye be led of the Spirit, ye are not under the law. I'm talking about being following Christ and the leading of the Spirit. Now, sometimes I'm going to tell you something. If I step on some toes, and so be it. But I think sometimes it's a shame. I think we've got a great church, and I think a lot of the times we know what the moving of the Spirit is, and we're obedient to it. But I think some of us, I'll include me. Sometimes the Lord will say, lift up that hand. Just lift it up and give me glory and honor and praise. And you know what? I'll confess. Sometimes I sit here just like the rest of you do. And you know what? The key to the service might be me just lifting up that hand. If he says walk around and lift up those hands, that's what I want to be found doing, Robin. I would hate to think that I was the key to blessing and moving this whole service. And it come out, and he says, you wasn't obedient. I couldn't do what I wanted to do. We can grieve the Holy Spirit. The Bible tells us that. Do we grieve him when he says, I want glory and honor out of you, or I just want you to do a little thing? Do we grieve him? Is the Spirit crying because we can't be obedient to him and follow his leading? I'm talking about being obedient and following the leading of the Spirit. It's just a little thing sometimes. You know, most everybody thinks, I'm praying for this certain thing, and Lord, if that's your will, use an extreme exaggeration, but let a lightning bolt come down and hit me. You know where I'm at? I just want to know your will, Lord, and it's got to be plain in my face before I do anything. But we can't even follow the small, still voice that bid us to come and lay our life down and say, yes, I accept you as my personal Savior. Whatever happened to that still, small voice that we've got to listen to? He's not changed. We've changed. We think he works in a different way, but he's still working through our hearts and our minds. Is that right? We're talking about let's be more obedient and following his steps to the leading of the Spirit. And then we find out also in Romans chapter 8. Let me flip over there as they come back to the music. Romans chapter 8. It says, therefore there is no condemnation to them which are in Christ Jesus. I'm going to tell you something. I'm just going to go ahead and just read this right out, okay? Therefore there is no condemnation to them which are in Christ Jesus, who walk not after the flesh, but what? After the Spirit. For the law of the Spirit of life in Christ Jesus has made me free from the law of sin and death. Thank God for the Spirit. For what the law could not do, and that it was weak through the flesh, God sending his own Son in the likeness of sinful flesh, and for sin condemned sin in the flesh, that the righteousness of the law might be fulfilled in us, who walk not after the flesh, but after the Spirit. For they that are after the flesh do mind the things of the flesh, but they that are of the Spirit, the things of the Spirit. For to be carnally minded is death, but to be spiritually minded is life and peace. You want life and peace? Because the carnal mind is enemy against God, for is not subject to the law of God, neither indeed can be. So then they that are in the flesh cannot please God. God help us to get rid of the flesh and get in the Spirit, that we can please you. But ye are not in the flesh. Now this is talking to you. But ye are not in the flesh, but in the Spirit. So be that the Spirit of God dwelleth in you. Now, if any man have not the Spirit of Christ, he is none of his. Excuse me a minute. And if Christ be in you, the body is dead because of sin, but the Spirit of is life because of righteousness. I want you to get this. But if the Spirit of him, oh, this is one of the best verses I love. But if the Spirit of him, I'm talking about Jesus, that raised up Jesus, talking about the Spirit raising Jesus from the dead, dwell in you, he that raised up Christ from the dead shall also quicken your mortal bodies by his Spirit that dwelleth in you. Therefore, brethren, we are debtors. How many of you remember the message I preached on that, being a debtor, about Paul? Any of you here for that one? But we're debtors, not to the flesh, but to live after the flesh. For if we live after the flesh, ye shall die. But if ye through the Spirit do mortify the deeds of your body, if we kill it, ye shall live. For as many as are led by the Spirit of God, they are the sons of God. Skipping on down, it says, for I reckon that the sufferings of this present time are not worthy to be compared with the glory which shall be revealed in us. Then it goes on down to say in 26, likewise the Spirit also helpeth our infirmities, that we know not what we should pray for as we ought, but the Spirit itself maketh intercession for us with groanings which cannot be uttered. And he that searcheth the hearts knoweth what is the mind of the Spirit, because he maketh intercession for the saints according to the will of God. If you're not a Christian today, what I just read, you can be. If you want that Spirit of God to come inside you, all you got to do is say, I accept you, I believe. But I feel a burden tonight. request, I thought, God, help us to pray for him. But you know, I read something today, not to take anything away from Jack, but it's talking about a preacher and going to a lady and saying, and giving her an invitation. She said, well, just pray for me. And he said, well, no, I'm not going to pray for you. And I thought, when I read that, and I thought, I misunderstood that. Let me go back here again. I read it again. It says, no, that's what he said. I'm not going to pray for you. And she said, well, wait a minute. What do you mean you're not going to pray for me? He said, you've heard everything that I've said to you. He said, now it's just up to you to believe. Amen. Is that right? And all of a sudden it says that something clicked in her mind, and she began to think, yeah, it ain't him praying for me. It's me praying for myself. It says that she came and she gave her heart to the Lord, and then she thanked him later for saying that. But let's follow Christ, number one, in prayer. Number two, in obedience. Number three, in following the way of the Spirit. Is that right? Is this a message to the church? And I'm going to tell you something. We've got a man here that I think I could follow him, and I think he's going to lead me right to heaven. The way you preach, you amaze me, Fred. I'll tell you, you probably get tired of me hearing you hear me say that to you as I come and say, man, that's the best message I heard you preach. Only to come around, he probably thinks I'm a big liar. The next time he preaches, I say, man, that was the best I heard you preach, Fred. Every time, he amazes me. And I thank you for following in Christ's steps. And like I said, the first portion of scripture that I give you, I wanted you to imagine of Brother Fred saying that, be ye followers of me, even as I am of Christ. Can I ask you a question tonight? Would you lead somebody to heaven if they followed your life? I'm talking mom, dad. I'm talking son, daughter. I'm talking everybody. Could you lead somebody to Christ if they followed in your steps and followed what you did every day? Would you lead them to heaven, or would you lead them a little stray and say, boy, I missed it. I missed it. I would hate to think that I've said something wrong, or I've did something contrary to the Word of God that would lead somebody astray. But I want to have that pure heart when I stand in front of God and say, I followed in your steps, Jesus. Just the way that you said, I've took every word, I've took this roadmap that you give me here, and I followed it. And you know what he's going to say? Well done, thy good and faithful servant. You followed the roadmap that I give you. You've made it. Entered into the joys of the Lord. Or would he say, no, my commandment said this, but you didn't obey it. You wasn't obedient unto it. Depart from me, for I never knew you, you workers of iniquity. With every head bowed and every eye closed. Do you feel that spirit that I've talked here tonight bidding you to come? Let's follow Christ and follow the leading of the Spirit. I'm going to leave one thing out, but I'm going to touch on real quick and real briefly. It's following Christ in holiness. I think we need to put it on as a church, that we can be a light into this lost and dying world, that if they would follow our holiness and see what we've got and see what we're doing in the church and everything, that we could lead them right into heaven. But is that spirit that I've talked about tonight, maybe it's not really banging real hard, and maybe it's not really screaming and yelling, but can you just hear that still small voice inside of you speaking to you ever so gently, saying, you need me. You need to have your sins forgiven. If there's one here, I bid you to come. And we'll give you that free pardon of sin. Jesus will. He's up here with outstretched arms just waiting to save you. Christians, but sometimes we might miss a step. Is that right? We might miss a step. Maybe we're not stepping in the right way of obedience, or maybe we're lacking a little bit. We've got just a half a step, not a whole step in prayer. I bid the whole church come, and let's follow in Christ's step. Whatever the Spirit leads to you to pray and seek His face, I bid you to come tonight as a church, a whole body. Let's pray and ask the Lord, Lord, how would you lead me? Can we just all come in and have a season of prayer?